Israel, this your brother K. Judah, giving all praise to the Most High Yah, in faith in Yahshua HaMashiach, and to my Israelite family worldwide, I say peace and blessings. You know, family, the carnal mind is enmity against God. It would not keep his commandments, because it hate his commandments. But those of us who are spiritual, we will keep his commandments. So I titled this podcast, The Law, Spiritual and Holy. The Law, Spiritual and Holy. So get you a Bible. Get you some pen and paper. Write these scriptures down, Israel, and study to show yourself approved. And let's get it.
Tell him I love him, it's good, the side of the globe. Is everything like it should, man, I don't know. But for everyone, I think they should go. If you say that it's over, if you say that it's over, I won't die.
A shame, it's a terrible waste. Beautiful mind, that was a moment in time when I thought of you. Now I am fine, no matter what.
Back to you. Yeah. You don't have to say you love.
You don't have to say you love.
You should tell the truth.
Ooh.
Everything you do in time.
You know it takes time.
Just goes back to you.
Yeah.
Just goes back to you. Yeah.
Again. looking for sure. If you say that it's over, I won't die.
All right, Israel, we're going to pick this up in Exodus chapter 19. The book of Exodus, chapter 19. The law, spiritual and holy. Exodus 19. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. The book of Exodus, chapter 19. And your brother K. Judah going to pick it up at verse 1. Exodus 19 and verse 1. And it reads, in the third month, when the children of Israel were going forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai, for they were departed from Rephidim and were come to the desert of Sinai and had pitched in the wilderness, and there Israel camped before the mount. Jump down to verse 9. Verse 9, and it reads, and the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. Now, first thing you need to understand, anytime Christ sends a message, he always used his angels. But this message was so important that the Lord came down himself, Israel. First thing you need to understand, that Christ came down himself to give these commandments. That's how important these commandments are. Let me read verse 9 again. And the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Let me know, the Lord don't like filth around him. The Lord don't like dirty people. He told them to wash their clothes. What else he said? Verse 11, and be ready against the third day, for the third day the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. Jump down to verse 14. Verse 14, and it reads, and Moses went down from the mount unto the people and sanctified them, and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. Jump down to verse 17. Verse 17, and it reads, and Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the neither part of the mount, and the Mount Sinai was all together on a smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire, and the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mount quaked greatly. And when the voice of the trumpet sounded long and waxed louder and louder, Moses spake, and God answered him by a voice. And when he spake to Moses by a voice, what did the Lord say? Let's go to Exodus chapter 20. Exodus 20, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Exodus 20 and verse 1. And it reads, and God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. So to us, Egypt is synonymous to bondage. Understand that, Israel. Verse 3, thou shalt have no other gods before me. First thing on the list. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the waters under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve thee. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Verse 7, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, For the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. And many of you who teach this book, you are taking God's name in vain because of your behavior and the way you conduct yourself when you bring forth the word of truth. Verse 8, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Read that again. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. So many of you, you come from Monday to Friday, and then you will say that the Sabbath day is on Sunday. So you will come from Monday to Saturday and then go to church on Sunday. But let me remind you that Sunday is the first day of the week. So you must come from Sunday to Friday. Then on the seventh day, the only day that God gave a name to, he did not name the other days. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord, Israel. Verse 10, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor the stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Now you see why your children dying. Now you see why your children are dying. They do not honor you. They do not respect you. But they do disrespect you on a daily basis. And God is putting them to death. Understand that. Verse 13. Thou should not kill. But in the New Testament, the Lord made it clear that thou should not murder, because we kill to eat. Verse 14. Thou should not commit adultery. God made it clear that in the New Testament, if you even look at a woman and lust after her, you already committed adultery. Verse 15, thou should not steal. That which don't belong to you, leave it alone. Verse 16, thou should not bear false witness against thy neighbor. And many of you do this on a daily basis. Verse 17, thou should not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou should not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. And all the people saw the thundering and the lightning and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when the people saw it, they removed and stood afar off. And they said unto Moses, speak thou with us, and we will hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, for God is come to prove you, for that his fear may be before your face, that you sin not. That you sin not, Israel. But according to the church, these commandments are too hard to keep. But everything I just read, family, is nothing wrong with that. Thou should not commit adultery. What's wrong with that? Thou should not steal. What's wrong with that? Thou should not murder. It's nothing wrong with that. These commandments are holy and good, family. Holy and good. Understand that, Israel. Let's go to Exodus 24. Exodus 24. So as you can see, Yahshua HaMashiach came down himself on Mount Sinai and spoke with our fathers. Exodus 24 and verse 12. Exodus 24. And verse 12, and it reads, and the Lord said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written, no man, which I have written, no man, K. Judah, which I have written that thou mayest teach them. So God wrote these commandments with his own finger. Let me say that again. Christ wrote these commandments with his own finger. That's how important these commandments are, family. They are not done away with. Do not let nobody tell you These commandments are done away with. They trying to take your life from you. Let's go to Exodus 31. Exodus 31. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 18. Exodus 31. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 18. Exodus 31 and verse 18. And it reads, "And he gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, two tables of testimony, tables of stone, written with the finger of God." Written with the finger of God. So much for man writing the commandments. God wrote these commandments with his own finger, Israel. That's how important. You need to understand that these commandments are. Any other time, the Lord will use an angel to bring the message. But it was so important that Christ came on Mount Sinai himself, and our fathers heard him speaking. Let's go to Exodus 32. Exodus 32. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Exodus 32 and verse 1. And after the Lord gave them these commandments, what did our fathers do? Let's see. Exodus 32 and verse 1. And it reads, "And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him." And they just talking about Moses like he just some regular man. Not understanding this the same man that God used to deliver them out of Egypt. Our fathers was crazy. Verse 2. "And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in your ears, of your wives, of your sons, of your daughters, and bring them unto me." And Aaron, come on, Aaron, you a man that God chose, handpicked, to be with your brother Moses, and you allow these people to cause you to commit a great sin against your power. This is what you call weak-minded. Don't let nobody cause you to sin against your power. This is what you call weak-minded. Verse 3. "And all the people break off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graven tool after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy God, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." How foolish, not understanding that it came out of your ear. How foolish, not understanding that it came out of your son's ears. How foolish, not understanding that it came out of your daughter's ears. Foolish people, man. Foolish. Verse 5. "And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, Tomorrow, it's the feast to the Lord." Woo! Now I get it. I understand, O Most High. O Most High, I understand, Father. O Christ of Messiah, I understand why you allowed to happen what has befallen us. They witnessed things we have never seen. Witness thy power. Witness the Red Sea splitting. And still sinned against you, still made a molten calf, and said that these be thy gods, O Israel, that delivered them out of Egypt. Foolish. Verse 6. "And they rose up early on the morrow, and offered burnt offering, and brought peace offering. And the people sat down to eat and to drink, and rose up to play." And we love doing that. We think everything a game. We think everything is a game until the drummer come. Then we want to weep and cry and ask God to have mercy. But if he never do, I understand. We are a stiff neck and forward people. Forward, man. Hard-headed, stiff neck. Don't listen. Verse 7. And the Lord said unto Moses, go, get thee down, for thy people. The Lord wouldn't even claim you no more. He told Moses, for thy people. Woo! He told Moses, for your people. The Lord wouldn't even claim you no more. He told Moses, let me read that again. And the Lord said unto Moses, go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest up out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. The Lord wouldn't even claim you. He told Moses, for your people, Moses, that you have brought up out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. He wouldn't even call you his people. He wouldn't even call you his people because of what you was doing. When Moses was in that mountain, getting them commandments for you to teach you, you down there making a golden calf. And you wonder why. You wonder why you were destroyed. But always crying to God to have mercy, but refused to listen, taking his mercy for granted. Jump down, family, to verse 15. Verse 15. And it reads, and Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two table of testimony were in his hand. The tables was written on both their sides, on the one side and on the other where they're written. And the tables were the work of God, and the writings was the writings of God graven upon the tables. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there is a noise of war in the camp. And he said, it is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is this the voice of them that cry from being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the camp and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot. And he cast the tables out of his hand and brake them before the mount. Did you hear that, family? Moses, a man that God handpicked, one of the most humble men on the earth, he saw them dancing and playing and worshiping a golden calf. And Moses break the two tables that was written with the finger of God because of his anger waxed hot. This is an example for me being a teacher of this word, that I would not allow anyone in this word to cause me to sin against my power. I'm not saying that Moses sinned right here, but I'm saying I would not allow anyone to cause me have the slip of the tongue in this word or cause me to sin against my power. And that's why I check myself on a daily basis and use discernment when I'm dealing with you, Israel. I must use discernment and patience because I know how you are. God know how you are more than me. But from teaching, I know how you get down. Understand that. I know how you get down. Let's go to Exodus 34. Exodus 34. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Exodus 34. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, and the Lord said unto Moses, hew thee two tables of stone, like unto the first. And I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first table, which thou breakest. And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto the mount Sinai, and present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. And God did not kill Moses. He wasn't even angry with Moses. He just told Moses to hew out two tables just like the first. But the first ones was the writings of God, the stones he carved out himself. So the duplicate cannot match the first. But he was not angry with Moses because he understood. God is an understanding God. And he understood that Moses' anger waxed hot because of our forefathers. Because of what they was doing, family. Jump down to verse 4. Verse 4. And it reads, and he hewed two tables of stone, like unto the first. And Moses rose up early in the morning and went up unto Mount Sinai. And the Lord had commanded him and took in his hand the two tables of stone. And the Lord descended in a cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. Jump down, family, to verse 27. Verse 27. And it reads, and the Lord said unto Moses, write thou these words, for after the tenor of these words have I made a covenant with thee and with Israel. And he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water. And he wrote upon the tables the word of the covenant, the 10 commandments. And on these 10 hang all the rest of the law. On these 10 hang all the rest of the law. But you talking about God knew we couldn't keep these commandments. So why did he give it to us? Why when we sin, we are punished? Because he know we can keep them. We just refuse to. Let's go, family, to Deuteronomy chapter 10. Deuteronomy chapter 10. The book of Deuteronomy, family, chapter 10. And your brother K. Judah gonna pick it up at verse 1. Deuteronomy chapter 10. And your brother K. Judah gonna pick it up at verse 1, family. And it reads, at that time the Lord said unto me, hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first, and come up unto me into the mount, and make thee an ark of wood, and I will write on the tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest, and thou shalt put them in the ark. And I made an ark of shittim wood, and hewed two tables of stone, like unto the first, and went up into the mount, having the two tables in my hand. And he wrote on the tables, according to the first writings, the 10 commandments, which the Lord spake unto you in the mount out of the midst of the fire in the day of the assembly. And the Lord gave them unto me. And I turned myself and came down from the mount and put the tables in the ark which I had made. And there they'll be as the Lord commanded me. So do you see, family, that God is the one who wrote the commandments? Moses had to hew out two more tables of stone so God can write on them what was written on the first, because Moses broke them because of his anger waxed hot. Jump down to verse 12. Verse 12. And it reads, and now, O Israel, what do the Lord thy God require of thee but to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command thee this day for thy good. Jump down to verse 16. Verse 16, and it reads, circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart, and be no more stiff-necked. We haven't got that message. We have not received that message. We are still stiff-necked. We have not got circumcised the foreskin of our heart, meaning our mind, because you eat more with your mind than your mouth. We have not got that message yet, because we are still stiff-necked. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We refuse to keep these commandments. You are preachers teaching that God's law is done away with, because they have no understanding. And you love to run to Paul, but you don't understand Paul's writings. 1 John chapter 2 And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. 1 John chapter 2. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, "My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not." Hold up, time out. This is the New Testament. But they say the law is done away with. But John just said that he's writing this unto us that we sin not. So we got to find out what sin is when I'm done with this. If you cannot sin, we must understand what is sin. But let me finish this first, family. "My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. And that he that said, I know him, and keeping not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that said he abide in him ought himself also to walk, even as he walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you." Read that again. "Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you." One more time. "Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you." Oh, so these are the same commandments that Christ gave on Mount Sinai. Because he just said, "I write no new commandment unto you." But a what? "Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment, which ye have heard from the beginning." The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. So these commandments are still in effect, Israel. They are not done away with. How we know that? Because if you are sinning and you are punished for your sins, what is sin according to the Bible? Let's go to 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. And I'm going to read one verse. Verse 4. 1 John chapter 3. And I'm going to read one verse. Verse 4. This is 1 John chapter 3, family. And your brother K. Judah going to read verse 4. And it reads, "Whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law." Also, if a person sins, they are breaking the commandments. Smoking and drinking is not in the commandments. That is not sin. But everything that is written in the commandments, if you break that, that is sin. Now, smoking is bad for you, like cigarettes. If you drink too much, it can cause problems in your health. But that is not sin. Now, if you try to use that you are the temple of God, what is dwelling in you that make you the temple of God? This word. So if you defile your temple, meaning blasphemy, or anything you do contrary to this word, you are defiling your temple. Because the word of God is dwelling in you. Smoking and drinking is not sin. Show me that in the law. Because if the Bible says you transgress the law, whatever is inside the law, if I break that, then I sin. Understand that, Israel. There's nowhere in the Bible where God says you cannot drink. You can drink wine or even say strong drink, a little Jack Daniels. Smoking cigarettes is bad for your health. But that is not sin. Understand that, family. Let's go to Romans chapter 7. Romans, because y'all love to run to Paul. Let's see what Paul said about the commandments. Romans. Chapter 7. Let's see what Paul said about the commandments, since y'all love to run to them. Romans chapter 7. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 7. Romans chapter 7. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 7. And it reads, "What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid." See, his commandments is not sin, family. Why, Paul? "I have not known sin but by the law. For I have not known lust, except the law have said, thou should not covet. So where there's no law, there's no sin. So before Paul understood the law, he did not know he was sinning. Understand that, Israel. Where there's no law, there's no sin. So how can God hold you accountable for sin if there's no law? So if the laws are done away with, we open to do whatever we want because we don't know we're doing wrong. Because Paul just said he did not know lust except the law have told him thou should not covet. Verse 8, but sin, taking occasion by the commandments, what in me, all manner of concupiscence, and that mean uncleanness. For without the law, sin was dead. So you see, for without the law, sin is dead. You cannot hold me accountable for that which I know not. But we know the commandments are still in effect because people are dying all the time because of sin. Understand that. Verse 9. For I was alive without the law once. But when the commandments came, sin revived and I died. Meaning the old man died. The old Paul died when he understood these commandments. He was a live sinner like many of us. Before we understood this, we were live sinners, breaking the commandments, doing things we should not, but we did not know. But once you know to do better, you have to do it, family. Understand that. Verse 10, and the commandments, which were ordained to life, I found to be unto death. For sin, taking occasion by the commandments, deceived me, and by it slew me, because it let Paul know what he was doing wrong. Verse 12, wherefore, the law, read that again. Wherefore, the law is holy and the commandments holy and just and good. But y'all run to Paul's writings. I thought the commandments done away with. Y'all love to run to Paul's writings. But Paul just told you that the commandments, they holy, just, and good. So that means they are good to keep. So if Paul is telling you to keep the commandments, how say some of you that the commandments are done away with? Because you don't have no understanding. Verse 13, what then? That which is good made death unto me, God forbid. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandments might become exceedingly sinful, because it lets you know how wrong you really are. Verse 14, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. Jump down to verse 21. Paul just told you the law is spiritual. Jump down to verse 21, and it reads, I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Because this flesh is always trying to kill you, Israel, on a daily basis. This flesh is always trying to kill you, family. That's why you do not have to overcome the world. You have to overcome you. You do not have to overcome the world. You have to overcome you. Because this flesh is always trying to get you to sin. Always trying to get you to do contrary to the commandments of God. Understand it. Verse 24. Oh, wretched man that I am, who should deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God. But with the flesh, the law of sin. And many of us have been in Paul's shoes. Many of us have been in Paul's shoes. Because this flesh is always trying to get you to sin against God. Understand that, fam. Let's go to Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah 31. The book of Jeremiah 31. 31. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 31. Jeremiah 31. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 31. The book of Jeremiah 31 and verse 31. And it reads, "Behold, the days come, said the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break. Although I was a husband unto them, said the Lord, but this should be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, said the Lord. I will put my laws in their inward parts and write them in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." He gonna write them in our mind. Because now, immediately in your mind, when you see a woman and she tell you she married, in your mind, can't talk to her. Let me keep it moving. Because the laws are in your mind. You don't need the fringes no more. Because the law is in your mind. I'm not telling you not to wear fringes, but he gave you that not for a fashion show, but to know to keep the commandments. It did not work. So now he made a new covenant to write the law in your mind. So I don't need the fringe because the laws are already in my mind. I know not to lust after another man's wife. I know not to steal. I know not to kill. I know not to covet because it's in my mind. Understand that, Israel. Understand that, family. It is in your mind. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 7. Hebrews chapter 8. And I'm going to pick it up, family, at verse 7. Hebrews chapter 8. And verse 7. And it reads, "For if that first covenant have been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them," not the covenant, "for finding fault with them," not the commandments, "for finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, said the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, said the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, said the Lord. I will put my laws in their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people." Now, when God say heart and mind, he's talking about the same thing, family. No different than the spirit and breath. Talking about the same exact thing. Because your heart don't make decisions. Your mind do. Because you eat more with your mind than your mouth. So he's going to write them in your mind that you may keep them and do them. Understand that, Israel. Let's go to Matthew 22. Matthew 22. Matthew 22, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 35. Matthew 22, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 35. Matthew 22 and verse 35, and it reads, "Then one of them, which was a lawyer," meaning somebody who knew the law, that's all lawyer mean, somebody who understood the law, "then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. So if you love God and you fear him, you go keep his commandments. That's why you must love him with all your soul, with all your mind. Because if you fear him and love him, you're going to do what he say, family. Understand that. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Precept on precept. Line up on line. Here little. There little. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. This is Deuteronomy chapter 6. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, "Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments, which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land, whether you go to possess it." Jump down to verse 4. Verse 4. And it reads, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart," meaning in your mind. In your mind. Understand that. John chapter 14. John chapter 14. And I'm going to read one verse. John chapter 14. "So if you fear God, you will obey God. If you do not fear him and have a carnal mind," that's enmity against God. It hate God. It hate his commandments. "It is not subject to the law of God." John chapter 14. And I'm going to read one verse. Verse 15. John chapter 14. And I'm going to read one verse. Verse 15. And it reads, "If you love me," read it again, K. Judah. "If you love me," not with lip service. "If you love me," not shouting and hooping and hollering. "If you love me, keep my commandments." That's how you show the Most High in Christ that you love him, by keeping his commandments. If you do not, you do not love him. Stop letting that roll off your lips because it sounds good. "Ooh, I love the Lord. He's my Savior. I'll do anything for him." But you don't obey anything. You don't obey anything. Refuse to keep the commandments. Refuse to keep the Sabbath day. Refuse to keep the feast days. But you love them, right? Let's go to John 15. Go over one book. John 15. Just go over one book, family. John 15. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. This is John chapter 15. And your brother K. Judah going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman." Sweet to my lips. "I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman." Jump down to verse 4. Verse 4. And it reads, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me." But what about your Old Testament Israelites? You don't believe in Christ. So what you got coming? Christ say you cannot get to the Father but by him. So that means you must abide in him. He's the true vine. But what if you do not believe in the true vine? Because the branches cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. Christ is the vine. Understand that. Jump down to verse 9. Verse 9. And it reads, "As the Father have loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." Oh, so even Christ had to keep the Father's commandments? Even Christ had to obey the Father. So if Christ kept the commandments, what make you think you don't have to keep the commandments? Saying you love him. Absolutely not. You do not love him. With your lips, you love him. But with your mind, it is far from him. Understand that. Jump down to verse 14. Verse 14. And it reads, "Ye are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you." And he gave us these commandments. So he commanded you to keep it, but you refused to. So you're going to be the one that go to Christ in that day and say, Lord, Lord, have we not done wonderful things in your name? Cast out devils, heal the sick. And he going to look at you and say, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who work iniquity. Don't let that be you, family. Do not let that be you. Let's go to Matthew 22. Matthew 22. Don't let that be you, family. Matthew 22. And verse 39. Matthew 22 and verse 39. This is the book of Matthew, chapter 22 and verse 39. One verse, verse 39. And it reads, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And this one thing I wish among Israel, we can really apply to our daily life. Loving each other with an unconditional love. You see your brother, your sister in need. Bear the infirmities of the weak. Bear the infirmities of the weak. Those who are weak in faith, uplift your brothers and sisters. Bear the infirmities of the weak. There's one thing I wish we could really apply to our life, and that's loving each other with an unconditional love. Understand that, family. Let's go to Romans 13. Romans 13. Romans 13. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 8. Romans 13. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 8. Romans 13 and verse 8. And it reads, owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. Why? Because if you love your brother, you're not going to do anything against him to break the law. That's why the Bible said, love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and the second is like unto it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Because if you love God, you're not going to break his law. If you love your neighbor, you're not going to do anything against him to break the law. Understand that, Israel. You're not going to do anything against your brother to break the law or your sisters. So watch how you treat the one that's standing next to you. Watch how you treat and talk to your people. Because God is looking. He's watching our behavior. And he's writing everything down that we say and do. Understand that, family. Pay attention. Verse 9. For this, thou should not commit adultery. Hold on, Paul, you saying this? Thou should not commit adultery. Thou should not kill. Thou should not steal. Thou should not bear false witness. Thou should not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou should love thy neighbor as thyself. I want y'all to know that was Paul talking. So if Paul say the commandments is done away with, why did Paul just say, thou should not kill, thou should not steal, thou should not covet, and you should love your neighbor as yourself? Sound like the same commandments. Sound like the same commandments that Christ gave on Mount Sinai. Sound like the same commandments to me that Christ came down on Mount Sinai and gave to Moses to teach the children of Israel. So how the commandments done away with? They are not done away with. You just don't have no understanding. Let's go back to Matthew 22. Matthew 22. Matthew 22. And this time, verse 40. Matthew 22. And this time, verse 40. Matthew 22 and verse 40. And it reads, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets, sweet to my lips. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Do you understand what he just told you? He say on these two commandments, which two? The one that you should love God with all your heart. Love your neighbor as yourself. On these two hang all the law. Why? Because if you love God, you're going to fear him and obey him. And if you love your neighbor, you're not going to sin against him. That's why on these two hang all the law. Understand that, Israel. Let's go to Matthew 5. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 17. Matthew chapter 5. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 17. And it reads, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled." All has not been fulfilled. Verse 19. "Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven." Now, how least can you get in the kingdom of heaven? He's talking about the lake with the snake. He's talking about the lake with the snake. Understand that, Israel. Let me read that again. "Whosoever, therefore, shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." This is Christ talking. So how the commandments are done away with? This is out of the mouth of Christ. Anything written in red is Christ talking. He say he have not come to destroy the law or the prophets. He only came to fulfill. So how you get the power and think that power gonna override Christ? It don't work like that. Paul cannot override Christ. So Paul is not telling you to break the commandments, that you don't have to keep the commandments. Paul is telling you, you don't have to keep the sacrificial law. That's the only commandment done away with. The sacrificing of animals, not the commandments. Understand the difference. Because you do not understand Paul's writings. So you twist the scriptures to your own destruction. Understand that. So I will advise you, family, if you don't understand something, do not let it utter from your lips. If you do not understand Paul's writings, leave it alone, because you might cause yourself to be destroyed. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 30. Deuteronomy chapter 30. Deuteronomy chapter 30. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Deuteronomy chapter 30. And I'm going to pick it up, family, at verse 1. And it reads, "And it shall come to pass, when all these things are come upon thee, the blessings and the curse, which I have set before thee, and thou shalt call them to mind, among all nations, whether the Lord thy God hath driven thee." Jump down to verse 3. Jump down to verse 3. And it reads, "That then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity and have compassion upon thee, and will return and gather thee from all nations, whether the Lord thy God hath scattered thee." Jump down to verse 8. Verse 8. And it reads, "And thou shalt return and obey the voice of the Lord, and do all his commandments, which I have commanded thee this day." So time out. Even when you gather us, you still talking about these commandments. So if they done away with, Lord, why are you still telling us about these commandments? Oh, because they are not done away with. So even in the kingdom, these commandments will still be in effect. Understand that. Jump down to verse 11. Verse 11. And it reads, "For this commandment which I have commanded thee this day, it is not hidden from thee, neither is it afar off. It is not in heaven, that thou shouldest say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it? Neither is it beyond the sea, that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it? But the word is very nigh unto thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. See, I have set before thee this day life and good, death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, and his statutes, and his judgment, that thou mayest live and multiply. And the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. Jump down to verse 19, and it reads, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. He even told you what to choose. But our fathers chose death, and we've been dying ever since. They chose death, so he gave them their heart's desire. Understand that. Let's go to Matthew 19. Matthew 19. The book of Matthew, chapter 19. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 16. Matthew, chapter 19. And your brother K. Judah, go pick it up at verse 16. And it reads, and behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good things shall I do that I may have everlasting life? And he said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Because Christ knowing his flesh, ain't nobody good. But if thou would enter into life, keep the commandments. Read that again, K. Judah. But if thou would enter into life, keep the commandments. Sweet to my lips. But if thou would enter into life, keep the commandments. So even Christ said you have to keep the commandments. So why I say some of you don't have to keep the law? Who have bewitched you? Who have bewitched you and lied to you? Somebody trying to take your life. You better open your eyes and discern the spirit, for you get cast somewhere you don't want to be. Understand that. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. You better discern and use the spirit before you get cast somewhere you don't want to be. And if you're sinning against God and you already know the consequences, evidently you do want to be there. Evidently you do want to be there if you're going to sin against this God. Anybody who sinned against this God, you are foolish. And I ain't talking about when you was in the world. I'm talking about when you came into this knowledge. I'm not talking about when you was in the world messing up. We all done that. But to come into this knowledge and still play with this word, woo, you are foolish. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Why was they baptized unto Moses? Because Moses was the mediator between God and man. Understand that. Moses is the only person that God talked to face to face. Everybody else, he either came to them in a vision, but Moses face to face. Understand that. So they was all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And did all eat that same spiritual meat. And did all drink that same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Oh, that was not the Father. That was HaMashiach, Yahshua. Oh, so he's the one on Mount Sinai. So what about you Old Testament Christians? The Bible just told you, Old Testament Israelites, the Bible just told you that was Christ that followed the children of Israel, who talked to Moses face to face. But you say there's no Christ in the Old Testament. But he's the one that delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, split the Red Sea, gave water out of rock. He's the one that rained manna down from heaven. Do you not understand who you are dealing with? You are dealing with the Son, not the Father. No one has ever heard the Father's voice or seen his shape. You've only been dealing with Yahshua HaMashiach. Understand that. Not the Father. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 13. We don't have to keep the commandments. The laws are done away with. Let's see what Christ said. Hebrews 13 and verse 8. Hebrews 13 and verse 8. One verse. Hebrews 13 and verse 8. And it reads, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. So if he's the same, he never got rid of his law. He don't change. He gave those commandments because he knew we could keep them. They just refused to. So all y'all out there talking about God knew we couldn't keep that old law, you are foolish. You foolish. These commandments are just, holy, and good, and spiritual. But if you're corner-minded, you would not keep these commandments because you are enmity against God, meaning you hate his law. Understand that. Let's go to Revelation 22. Revelation 22. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 12. Revelation 22 and verse 12. Revelation 22 and verse 12. And it reads, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work should be. Let me read that again. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work should be. I thought we don't got to have no works. One more time. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work should be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the first God in Genesis, the last God in Revelation. You understand what I just said? He's the beginning and the end, the only God you have ever known in his flesh and blood body, and the only God you will ever know in his flesh and blood body. Understand that. Verse 14, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. This is the last book of the Bible telling you to keep the commandments. The last book of the Bible telling you to keep the commandments, that you may enter in through the gate into the city. Let's go to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. And I'm going to read. Start at verse 1. I'm going to read 1 to 3. 1 John chapter 5, verse 1 to 3. And I got one more scripture after this. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 1. And it reads, whosoever believeth that Jesus the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begot, loveth him also that is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. They are not hard to keep. His commandments are not hard to keep, family. Understand that, Israel. Let's go to the last place. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And this will be last. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And this will be last. I pray somebody got some understanding, Israel. Don't let nobody take your crown from you, because your power is watching. Don't let nobody deceive you, because your power is watching. Read this book for yourself. I cannot save you. I can only teach you how to save yourself. And how I'm going to deliver myself is by teaching the word. Your blood would not be upon my hands if I sound the alarm. But if I do not sound the alarm, you're going to die in your sins. But the blood will be required at my hand. And I refuse to let that happen. So I'm telling you, read this book for yourself. Understand that, Israel. Read for yourself, family. This the last place. Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, and verse 13. Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, and verse 13. And it reads, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So that's the lesson. The law, spiritual and holy. And your brother K. Judah want to say shalom.
Thinking about the world, looking at the nation. Suicide, genocide, homicide. Three words come to mind. Times are changing, yeah. No more rumors, there are wars going on. Twisted doctors, scientists making clones. Economy got some backs against the wall. People dying for no reason at all. People of God don't even read their Bibles. There's no faith, no trust in the word. But everybody seems to be quoting scripture. It's just another word they heard. Pastors leaving pulpits cause they're tired. It's all based on how we feel. Overheard two people speaking the other day. One said that God's not real, but I'm just one of them more people who's got a hold on. Sometimes I can't see, but I still believe he's taking care of me. Oh, I'm just one of them old people God's got a hold on. I believe, yeah. So I'll choose to look on the brighter side in spite of all the negativity I'm surrounded by. No, it ain't perfect, but that's alright. Cause his hand is on me and it's keeping me alive. So many disappointments. So much I don't understand. So much I don't have answers for. That's what makes me trust you more. In a world that's always changing, everything's rearranging. But no matter what's going on, I'ma be standing, I'ma be holding on. Your truth, their truth, my truth. Your God, my God, our view. All I know is one thing nowadays, is we all need hope, we all need faith. And I'm just one of them old people who's got a hold on. Sometimes I can't see, but I still believe he's taking care of me. Yes, he is. Oh, I'm just one of them old people God's got a hold on. Don't you let go of me, Lord, please. I believe, yeah. Oh, I'm just one of them old people who's got a hold on. Sometimes I can't see, but I still believe he's taking care of me. Yes, he is. Oh, I'm just one of them old people God's got a hold on. I believe.
Cursed be the ground for our sake.
both thorns and thistles, it shall bring forth for us. For out of the ground we were taken, for the dust we are. And to the dust we shall return.